Thanks for clicking on to the Tuesday edition of Vogan's European Outlook. Back on Sunday in the live stream, I made mention about the possibility of something colder towards the end of March, beginning of April. And we're going to revisit what I spoke about back over the weekend in today's video. Be sure to like, share and subscribe if you haven't already done so. There is plenty of things coming up here in the coming weeks to come. Building the summer forecast now, so I'm going to start to develop my ideas in the coming weeks, looking at rainfall distribution, MJO, what's going on within even the stratosphere, believe it or not, it's global sea surface temperatures. The Atlantic is very warm compared to average at the moment. What influence is that going to have on the atmosphere, both over the UK and Ireland, Europe, but also across the Northern Hemisphere? So this is the upcoming 7 days of the CFSV2, a very warm signal compared to average at least. And the reason why: high pressure over the near continent, low pressure over the Atlantic. We've got south to southwesterly airflow that is going to be driving warmer than average temperatures across the British Isles. And we are going to see relatively wetter than average conditions as well. If you look at the 7 day rainfall anomaly here off the model, you can see firmly wet than average conditions. But as we go forward, you notice here that we start to trend a little bit drier, and that may be indicative of the shift in the upper air pattern. But what is driving this current warm spell? If we actually look first of all at the GFS extended, this is the northern hemispheric view for the same period, for the upcoming 7 days, which is the 11th through the 18th of March. And you can see, you know, the UK, Ireland and Europe is tilted to the left here. So you have to kind of look to the left to see the UK and Europe. But notice the warmer than average Europe, but also notice warmer than average North America. And I also want to cast your attention over to what's going on within the high latitude. So within the Arctic region, you can see that the model indicates colder than average temperatures, which is quite interesting. So we've got a warm North America and a warm Europe. We have got a marginal cold over central northern Asia, if you notice here, but there is quite a lot of warmth in the pattern at this moment in time. The question is a couple of things. Now, this is what the latest MJO seen by the GFS, or the Global Forecast System, for the current situation. And this correlates very nicely. So firmly in four and five, well away from the null phase, which means it is having a greater influence on the mid to high latitude pattern within the northern hemisphere when you've got this Mandulan oscillation signal in phases four and five. That is correlating to upward motion, northern Australia through Indonesia into southeastern Asia. We're probably seeing enhanced rainfall in parts of Southeast Asia with this pronounced phase 4 and 5 MJO signal. And I think that is potentially, and the question mark is there an influence of El Nino? Likely so. So the combination of the MJO and the El Nino is likely having an influence on delivering this temperature anomaly profile for the next 7 day period. But I want to draw attention to this here. This is quite interesting. Now, I know we're not talking about December, or January or February. When it comes to cold, I'm talking about unseasonably chilly temperatures for the time of the year. So I want to emphasize that point, that when I'm talking about cold, I'm talking about colder than average temperatures given the time of the year. I don't want people jumping on that and saying, Mark, winter's long gone. Why do you keep talking about cold spells and whatnot? This is... you can still get, even into the month of April, snowfall and also quite cold temperatures, both by day and particularly so by nighttime. Now, the MJO by the GFS ensemble is indicating to go into phases 6 and into phases 7. That then correlates to blocking high pressure over UK and Europe. And if we can get the MJO to rotate into phases 7, that then would indicate more northerly blocking, so a Greenland block. And obviously in the middle of the winter, it would correlate to cold UK conditions if the setup and if the block sets up in the right areas. This is what I'm trying to get at. This is the point I'm trying to make. do we have the continued warming influence of the El Nino, like we've seen back during mid to late January and right the way through February, even through much of March, by the way? We've seen, I think, the El Nino overtake any other teleconnection. In other words, overtake stratospheric warming, which we've seen several of. We've also seen the MJO in favourable phases for cold, and it has not materialised. So what's the difference? Why all of a sudden would we now get the MJO coming back into play once again, given the fact that it was kicked out of the playing field by the El Nino? Do we see the atmosphere respond to the MJO once again? Remember, the feedback is becoming different. The jet stream is now starting to naturally weaken. And it's what's going to be interesting is, do we see some sort of MJO forcing to reinforce this idea? We also have to take into consideration the stratospheric warming, the wind reversal within the 60 degrees north mean zone of winds has been in an easterly mode now for at least a week, even possibly 10 days, where we've had that easterly mean zonal wind, meaning that we've had a lot of warming take place within the stratosphere, forcing the very significant weakening of the polar vortex. So what I think I'm trying to get at, or what I know I'm trying to get at, but I'm trying to make it as plain as possible for everybody else, is that I think the question is, do we get the blocking to develop after this current spell of milder than average, firmly milder than average conditions? So this is the current MJO firmly in phases 4 and 5. That is then responding to a firmly warmer than average upcoming 7-day period. This is the 8th to 14th. So this is taking us out to the 19th through the 26th of March. But the upcoming 7 days is very warm compared to average, and that is a classic textbook phase 4 or 5 strong MJO signal, possibly combined with the influence of El Nino. And also to factor that in is the warm Atlantic waters also. So the MJO possibly going through phases 7-6 into possibly phases 7, and the model. Now watch this here as we go forward. This is the GFS extended, of course. And you play through this loop and notice the change in the overall signal with cold conditions, especially across the north of North America. Look at Canada, how much it turns colder. So is this the response to the MJO shifting out of phases 4 and 5 into phases 6, into phases 7? In conjunction with the stratospheric warming that we've seen ongoing for the last week to 10 days. So this is going to be the test. I'm not saying that this is definitely going to happen and all of a sudden we have winter coming back into play once again. But you can see the overall thinking behind the overall concept. Look at the difference compared to what we've got now. This is right towards the 20th of March through the first 4 days of April. Let's look at Europe specifically. We'll go back to the current upcoming 7-day period, and you can see firmly warmer than average conditions. Then as we play through the loop, look at how much it turns around, and we see colder than average conditions, right the way through week 1 of April. I'm not necessarily saying that April is going to be a colder than average month overall, because we can get a very cold end to March, beginning of April, and then we start to see a change in the pattern. We've seen it in December, we've seen it even during parts of January, where the first 19, 20 days of the month was actually firmly colder than average, but you get a week to 10 days of firmly warmer than average. And it's amazing how quickly you can turn that anomaly, that cold anomaly, into a warm anomaly. And given how warm the surrounding waters are around both UK, Ireland, but also across Europe, it doesn't take an awful lot at this time of the year with the stronger incoming solar radiation to just turn that anomaly around. So I'm not necessarily saying this is going to be a cold April, but it wouldn't entirely surprise me nonetheless if we did get something on a colder note. quite often when you've got these warm winters, you can have a couple of cold spring months, even a couple of cold summer months. You know, warm winters doesn't necessarily correlate to either a cold summer or a warm winter. It's not as simplistic as that, unfortunately. But certainly you can see the ideas that I've got here, and it will be interesting to see what takes place as we go towards the final, I think the final 10 days of the month. Really, the next 10 days are going to be firmly warmer than average, I think. Let's have a look quickly at the upper pattern here. So this is the 500 millibar geopotential height anomalies, and you can see the turnaround in the model overall. So this is the upcoming 7-day period, and you can see that we've got quite a lot of negatives within the Arctic region. You've got a bit of a positive here over the Baffin Straits, but also you notice that we've got ridging over the eastern half of the United States, ridging over Europe here. So again, there's that phase 4-5 of the NGO. As we play through this loop, you can see the turnaround in the upper air pattern shifting around, and then you start to drop those troughs that was over the Arctic region, one into North America, one into the UK and Ireland here. We still have a positive over Eastern Europe, if you notice, but there's that positive to the east of Newfoundland over the North Atlantic, shuts down the Atlantic, and therefore we get something more of a kind of north to northeasterly flow. So it's going to be one of those scenarios where if you're looking for warmer, drier weather, unfortunately, we could be taking a couple of steps back as we move towards the month of April. So it's all to play for. Like I've said already, live streams now becoming a feature of Sundays here in the channel. So you can watch the previous live stream back if you've missed it. If you enjoy it, drop a comment below and let me know what you think. And all being well, this upcoming Sunday, I will have edition 85 of the Global Weather Report live here from Marfogan HQ. So something to look forward to, all being well, this upcoming weekend. So plenty of things going on at the moment here. I will be talking about the hurricane season. I'm going to try and maybe look towards providing some sort of a summer forecast for the United States. It's been a few years since I've done that, actually. And there's going to be plenty of content here on the channel. So stay tuned, like, share and subscribe, and I'll see you again, all being well, tomorrow with a look at the more day-to-day weather for the rest of this week. Thanks for watching. Bye for now.